Take one world-class artist. Here he is, with his accoutrements, working away. Take also a gimlet-eyed bird of prey, a beautiful British snake, a very attractive audience. Add a little dash of level-headed Joe. Mix it all together and simmer for the next half hour. And you've got Springwatch Unsprung! Yay! Now, what... Blimey, that's going like the clap. Now, what is Springwatch Unsprung? Remember, it is where we try to answer some of your questions and some of your observations on the wonderful world of wildlife. We throw in a few things of our own. We ask you for questions. Look what we've got. A great wodge of them. We'll try and get through as many as we can. Royce is just slowing down the table. And you've sent us lots of things as well, and we'll be examining some of those a little bit later on. Right. Our world-class artist, we'll be coming back to him. It's Darren Woodhead. We'll be looking at his work, but we've set Darren a little task. He is trying to produce a fabulous work of art. There he is. Work of art. While the programme is on in the next half hour. He has started a little bit earlier, but he's actually looking at the birds and things he's painting through his telescope as he works. We'll go back to him in a minute. We received a photograph from Charlotte Varela. She was so inspired by wildlife, she's had a tattoo. There it is. It's a long-tailed tit. It's on her wrist. Lovely, Charlotte. Thank you very much. And that has inspired us for our quiz tonight. And our quiz is...
Tattoos!
Whose tattoos? OK, here it goes. It's slightly risque, this quiz. What you've got to do, have a look at these pictures. Now, you have to match... the tattoos to the faces underneath, OK? So you'll see that it's me, and we've got lovely Kirsty, who works on the programme, and Mr Chris Packham. And these tattoos have to be matched to these people. That's the quiz, OK? And there's a supplementary quiz, which is that tattoo, which may or may not be my tattoo. That tattoo has a special significance, that tattoo, and you've got to tell us what is that special significance. Level-headed Joe, are you standing by to receive the answers?
Absolutely.
And will you ring the tinkly bell when the first correct question answer comes in, OK?
Martin, do we have to also guess what part of the body they're on? Because I think that one that you said was on the wrist was actually on the arm.
Was it?
Yes, otherwise
she said the wrist.
Oh, really?
I wasn't, yeah.
Oh, it looked like an arm to me, didn't it? You? I mean, like an arm.
OK.
Isn't the wrist part of the arm?
I beg to differ.
We will have some quick-fire questions. And the very first one involves one of these, if I can grab it. This has come from Geoffrey Hill in Moray. Will you please, Chris, examine that object? I love the way they come in exciting specs out. He says, dear Springwatch team, we have a wildlife pond, frogs, newts, beetles, etc., with a healthy population of snails, pond snails. In the spring, we find half a dozen caches of up to 50 snail shells buried under the grass at the side of the pond. Who's eating them?
These are ram's horn snails, and you can see that they're very distinctly ram's horn shaped, and these are really nice big snails, so that's a healthy pond, which is good. But you can see that they've been opened on the side here. Now, I think that had they been broken open by a song thrush, one, they wouldn't be buried under the grass, yes. They would be close to an anvil, and they would be smashed to pieces. I think these have been opened by a mammal that's chewed through the side here, just to the point where it's able to get a grip on the animal's body and pull the remainder of the flesh out of it. Now, in the past, I've found water voles that have eaten banded snails and then hidden them in their runs, and also rats as well that will eat these. So I'm definitely going for rodent, obviously without the context of seeing where the pond is. Well, close to water, I'm going for brown rat.
Brown rat, brown good skills. There you are, Joffy. Yeah. He's answered it. Let's move on to a sound one. Now, we've got a question from Martin Barber, and it's about this glorious sound. Everyone know what it is? Come on, don't be shy. What is it?
Skylark.
He knows. Skylarks. The epitome of spring, if you like. But if you notice, it seems to go on and on and on. And we've noticed birds right here in this here doing the same thing. Have a look at this. I couldn't do that. It goes on and on. Now, Martin Barber says, how does Skylark sing so constantly? How do they go on and on?
Well, in simple terms, they can sing whilst they're breathing in and breathing out at the same time. We normally speak, obviously, as we breathe out. We can because we breathe in. But it doesn't work terribly well for us. But birds can sing at an equal volume as they breathe in and out. But they've also got a very different structure in their throat. We have a larynx at the root of our trachea and where the bronchial tubes split up. They have something called a syrinx. Now, ours only has one tympanum, so we can only produce one sound at a time. Birds have two, which means that they can actually produce two parts of a song at the same time. Effectively, if we had a syrinx, we could talk to ourselves. Which would be disastrous in some instances, I would have to say. So, yes, they've got a very different structure there. So, and not only that, the muscles in the syrinx, as I recall, are the fastest recorded vertebrate muscles ever. Not as fast as the froghopper, of course, but much faster than our blinking eye. And this is how they're able to produce such complex song. And one thing they can do is use one to sing at one point whilst they're using the other, breathing in, to sing at the same time. So that's
wonderful.
The gist of it, I think.
Well, do you know, people can do circular breathing. It takes a lot of practice.
Go on, you're going to tell me you can,
mate. No, I can't, but that's how you play the didgeridoo. If you think about the didgeridoo,
it's... Of course, yeah, it is. She can always do it without it.
But it's hard. It's really hard. A lot of practice.
OK, Nick, this is one for you.
OK.
We have been sent some wonderful footage. This is from Caroline... Neil and Caroline Smith... What is this?
That's
under snow. Oh. There it is.
Right.
It's a mole running around on the set. They saw it. They were going ice climbing in the Cairngorms in spring, and they managed to film that mole. Well, Nick, we know it's a mole. What's it doing in the snow?
Well, I can only guess at this, and it sometimes happens in the summer as well for the same reason. You see moles very occasionally on the surface. It's what they feed on. They feed on invertebrates, mainly worms, and these live in the soil. So if the soil is frozen, these animals aren't going to move anywhere, so they'll be hiding up. And, of course, the mole needs them, so they're getting quite desperate. So often they'll bust out of the soil and go and basically try and find a new site. So this happens in the summer as well when the soil's really dry, so that worms will aestivate. They'll hibernate, the equivalent of hibernation in the summer, because it's dry. So, again, the worms aren't active. So I think that's probably what we're seeing there. We're seeing a desperate mole, looking for food, basically.
Ground's frozen. Amazing. That's what it is, isn't it?
Ground's frozen, can't get food.
Desperate mole. Not good to be in the
story.
Open, though, mate.
No, no.
A white mole on white... a black mole on white snow, even.
White mole would
I've all gone negative. Completely negative. Nothing unusual there.
Now, we've had a question from Stuart Robertson. He says, is the kestrel the only bird of prey that can hover, or are there others? Well, let us see and meet a kestrel. Jemima, please come on in.
Hello.
This is Greaves. And he or she?
She's 5 years old now.
Now, can you answer that question, Jemima? Is the kestrel the only bird of prey that hovers?
No, barn owls will hover, so you can see them hovering over long grass. And if you occasionally, you'll see buzzards doing just a short hover. They can't do as long a hover as these can.
Let's just have a look. I think we've got some footage. You never get tired of watching this. Absolutely beautiful. The head is rock solid. When you take Greaves out, presumably she'll fly like this?
Yeah, she will hover. She's a bit lazy, and she'll hover and get lower and lower and lower and lower. Which is not exactly what you want, but she'll do it.
Now, it's very fascinating, because this time of year, obviously, birds of prey have to molt. They have to change their feathers.
Yeah.
But a bird of prey like a kestrel... If they start molting, they won't be able to go out hunting. So how do they do it?
It's really cool the way they do it. What happens is that when the female starts to lay eggs, once she's started sitting, she'll start to throw out as many feathers as she can, because her husband's going to be working very hard bringing food in to feed her. So she's got about 31 to 33 days of incubation. And then the first couple of weeks, while the babies are getting their secondary down and keep warm, and then she is through a lot of the molt by then. Then she goes and joins hubby, helps work with getting food for the kids, and he starts to molt when the things he's going to catch have got young, which are easier to catch.
How amazing.
It's cool, isn't it?
It's absolutely fascinating. So she is not very good at hunting because she's molting, but he looks after her while she's in the nest.
Absolutely.
Absolutely fascinating. She's absolutely gorgeous. How do they actually molt quickly? I mean, they don't chuck out all the feathers at a time. It's very strictly regulated.
It is. What tends, and it's, we always know when it's ready to give our birds a rest, because usually the first feathers that go are the centre two tail feathers.
Right.
And that's the one that carries her bell. Yes, oh, yeah. It does. And she drops those two. They come about halfway down, then the next two go. Yeah. The first two are fully down, the next two are halfway down, the next two go. And the same thing happens in the wings. It happens in pairs all the way across.
In pairs as it goes.
It's really
absolutely
cool.
Fascinating. Well, we've got a question from the audience, I think, about it. Where's Maureen? Maureen, ask us your question, please.
Martin, I wanted to know, what do we have to do to encourage kestrels to nest in our gardens? What sort of things can we do?
Well, we can ask Jemima. How do we
nest
do it?
Boxes are really important. All of the cavity nesting birds are having a really bad time at the moment, so it's not just kestrels. So if you can put up nest boxes, it's great. There's tons of different designs on Google. If you Google bird nest boxes, there's lots there. It's where you put them. You've got to be careful not to damage the tree. Face them into your warmest wind, probably south or southwest. Put a perch on the outside, so when they do have babies, the babies can come out onto the perch and practice flapping. And it's really important to put something in the base of the nest box, because kestrels don't build a nest, neither do owls. They dig a sort of hole in the detritus in the bottom of an old tree. So if you can put in dry molehill soil, dried leaves, about that deep, then they can dig a little scrape and lay their eggs.
Imagine having one of those in your garden. Wouldn't that be
cool,
absolutely fantastic? It would. And they need our help at the moment.
Absolutely.
Now, insects also need our help occasionally. And a young man, Connell Rhodes, has decided on his own bat to go out and try and help our insects. Here he is.
My name is Connell Rhodes. I am 9 years old. I have made an insect hotel. An insect hotel is somewhere where insects can go and live safe from birds and all of the animals that would eat insects. My grandma got me a booklet, a plan for the insect hotel, and it took 2 months to build it. Filled it in with all sorts, cones, sheep wool, wood with holes in, bricks with holes in, bamboo. The holes are for the insects to go in and live in there, and some of the holes have things in that the insects can eat. I think it's quite big for some insects. Looks more like someone who's about 5 could fit in it if there were big enough doors. I think that wood lice would go in and live in the wood, and beetles would as well. Spiders would go and live there in some holes and make webs in the big ones. So far I've seen a beetle and some flying insects. Martin, I would like to know how to attract hedgehogs to come live in my insect hotel. I've put signs by the hedgehog homes, one spike, one snuffles.
Absolutely brilliant. Well, Connell, I will pass you over to my colleague, Michaela, to tell you how to attract hedgehogs.
First of all, can I say that is absolutely fabulous what you have done. Brilliant. Really, really good. But I guess, actually, there was a little bit of it around the entrance already, but you want to put logs and twigs around the entrance. Not only does it stop the wind going in, but they also like to sneak into their houses. So that would be my first tip. Second tip is try and draw them in by feeding them. Never put milk out, remember. Put dog food out, mincemeat, maybe some chopped eggs, and see what happens. Good luck. But you are doing a very good job at encouraging wildlife.
Absolutely fantastic. Oh, oh-ho! Aha, level-headed. First time you tinkly bell.
Well, quite a few people have got it right.
I think the whole thing?
Well, nearly the whole thing. I think a flash of flesh has sent everyone into a frenzy. Hundreds of answers. There's a few wrong answers for C, a few people get good guesses.
Okay. OK.
Shall I give you some wrong answers so far? People think...
Give us some wrong answers.
Sam Spilsbury thinks it's the leftovers from a bunch of grapes. Julia Marie Barley thinks it could be a poodle. Is that a hint?
Oh.
And Vicky Vernon says it looks like a maths equation. None
Very
of them quite
right.
Quite
OK, close.
But yeah. Somebody's got it absolutely right, have they, the whole thing? Yeah. OK, we'll come back to that in a minute. OK. Oh, shall we just remind ourselves what the quiz is? Here you go. I wonder how the audience are doing in here. That's it. You've got to match the faces to the tattoo. Whose tattoos? Lovely. That's a beauty, isn't it? Right. Now, let's move on. I love this one. Here it is. We've been sent some of these lovely objects. This one has come from Mrs. Vine. She said, sorry, no poo for Chris to play with, but I found this skull whilst on a National Trust volunteer holiday. Well, actually, we're going to pass it over to Nick. We're going to pass it over to Nick, Chris.
Okay, I thought it was a pie. I was really looking forward to that.
Nick, what is it, please?
That. Well, the giveaway, right, is the fact the jaw is still articulated to the skull. Oops. The tooth just fell out. all the muscles, the Weasel family do that. They all have a jaw that's basically will not leave the top part of the skull there, and that's for a nice powerful bite. That big crest on the back is where the jaw muscles attach. You know, lions have, that's called the sagittal crest.
Lion.
And, you know, you think, well, this is going to be some big, vicious predator. But it eats earthworms, pretty much. This is a badger.
It's a
badger skull, yeah. Very, very good find. One of my favourite, most sculptural British mammal skulls,
you
I think.
You don't happen to have a fox skull in your pocket to compare it with, do you, mate?
Funny you should mention that. I've got this one here. It's not a complete one. The jaw's fallen off this one, you know, straight away, wouldn't happen with our badger here, but... There's your fox skull, and you've got an idea of the size
Brilliant.
Difference there.
Lovely.
Completely different shape. And if it had teeth, I'd better show you they're much more sort of... Well, none of them got teeth, so I give up. I'm not going to... There's no point even talking about this.
Beautifully done, mate. Absolutely fantastic. Let's take in a spot of art, excuse me. Darren, look at this. Absolutely fantastic. Yeah, round of applause for this. Look at me. You like to do these. How long do they take to do these?
I do everything outside, so less than a day. So it happens in that one day.
It happens in one day?
In one day. Sometimes they're less than that. The studies are quicker than that. Some of these ones may be taking a winter's day, perhaps.
Right.
But no, everything's done outside and everything's just direct in brush.
Now, some of these, I notice, are quite splodged.
Yeah.
Are they? And why is that?
Because it's done outside, I mean, I'm out in all weather, so rain, snow, if the paint freezes, it's texture for me. It's something to work with, and when something like that happens, it's excitement. It's part of the day. It's what was happening then. It's the environment's come into the painting in many ways.
Absolutely. So that, literally, if it rains, that it just runs a bit, that's all part and parcel of the
texture,
painting.
The texture is caused by rain.
Fantastic. They're absolutely beautiful. Long-tailed tit family, the wax wings... Absolutely. Now, you've been out on the reserve.
Yes.
I think we've got a little film of you out there. Let's actually have a look at you at work out on the reserve. Where is it? Let's have a look. There you are. Now, take us through it, Dan. Here you are.
Yeah, I mean, when I'm out, for me, it's about I'm looking, I'm observing, I'm finding subjects. But I like to be in one place. I like to know my environment. So certainly here on the reserve, I found this one spot where they pied flycatchers, which I don't see much at home. So, I mean, I was there, pied flycatchers, great, it gives me a subject, and I was there for the whole day, and I saw one fledge, another one fledge this morning,
this
whilst I was
magical.
Painting.
I mean, it's just amazing how a couple of these strokes from your brush, and it just appears, just comes to life on the page.
Brush itself, it's fascinating, it's an incredible thing, so you can do line, colour, shape, form, just with a flick of a brush, with a flick of the hand.
Yeah, but you keep looking as well. You keep watching your... Just to get the whole... the feel of the bird itself.
Well, observation's the key, isn't it? As naturalists, we observe, we look, we look to understand, we look to learn. And it's the same with art and drawing. I mean, when you're looking to observe and learn.
That's absolutely fantastic.
It's hard to actually portray a blue-tit head, isn't it? Unless you actually draw it, then you can recognise the actual... markings themselves.
Have we got
They're
that
alive.
Picture?
The pictures are alive.
The picture are alive. So this was the one that we just saw you doing?
Yeah, that's right.
And there it is. Oh, look at
but
that.
The white of the paper is the key for me, so I want the item to move around the white. We can suggest, can't we? We don't have to pick out everything on a bird. We can suggest an outline is.
That's beautiful. I love the way, it's the white, it's what you don't put paint on
exactly.
that brings it to life.
Yeah, exactly. You're working negative in many ways.
That's fantastic. Yeah, exactly. We're going to say, are you still working on that?
I'm still working, yeah,
we're going to come
working.
And see that one. Absolutely. Thank you for joining us. Round of applause. Lovely. We'll see you in a minute. We'll catch up with you. Right. Thank you. Now, talking of observing nature, we quite often on Springwatch see birds mating, and it's not an elegant thing to watch at all. Let's have a look at it. Now, of course, birds don't have a proper penis, so it's really difficult for them, as you can see, to ensure that they mate. And my friend Greg the climber would... Oh, he looks quite pleased with himself. Greg the climber wants to know, Chris, how do birds do it? It looks very ungainly.
It is hit and miss because they don't have what we call intermittent organs, which will guarantee that the sperm from the male will get into the female. As you know, they have something called a cloaca, which is the end of the urethra, where the urine comes from, the end of the anus, where the faeces come from, and also where the sperm will come from. And they literally have to put these two orifices together. Now, when you're wobbling around on the back of a bird and you're trying to squeeze around with your tail and the feathers in the way and it's windy, it's hugely unsuccessful. And that's why we see birds mating so often. I remember reading once, when it came to kestrels, that in order to fertilise just one egg, they may have to copulate up to 25 times. Now, evolution works in devious ways, and when it becomes really, really difficult, for instance, when you've got water involved, some of the ducks, they have begun to develop what we call intermittent organs, sort of rudimentary penises. And I've read somewhere that in proportion to its body size, the ruddy duck has the largest penis. It's quite a small bird, but it's got to guarantee to deliver that sperm. So that's what they do.
Absolutely fascinating. Very difficult. There you go, greater climber. This is sort of complicated business altogether. Now, we promised you grass snakes. We've got grass snakes. Let us go to the grass snakes immediately.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
It's absolutely gorgeous. Yeah. Now, Nick, we've noticed, I was under complete misapprehension. I thought snake... Has it pooed on you?
No, yet? No. Well, it has, but that's another thing. Look, at look timing, right, in spring, which is, you know, we struggle a bit with... Look at this for good timing.
Oh, it's actually shedding its skin.
It's shedding its skin as we speak in one nice glow. So you're getting the best of a snake. It looks its brightest right now. How fab is that?
Now, I've got to ask, though... literally, was that poo or skin?
No, it's not poo.
Skin is shedding its skin live on British television.
That's for you, present.
Crikey. Now, Chris, very quickly, I thought that snakes either were constrictors that squeeze their prey to death, or they were like an adder, they were venomous. But when we saw the grass snake taking those chicks, it was neither.
No, that's right. They just use their brute strength. They try to grab the animal that they're going to eat by the head because they'll swallow that first, because typically the fur or the feathers will be facing in the opposite direction. So they want that to slide easily down the throat. In order to get the animal down, if it's much larger than them, they have a skull which can virtually completely disconnect. Held together, all of the plates in the skull with elastic fibres, the only bits which don't separate are the brain case and the eyes, which means they can open their mouth, and they sometimes produce an excess of saliva, so it slides down easily. Don't need a pint of beer.
Fantastic. So, yeah. And back to you, Nick. How do you encourage... How do you get snakes, grass... Oh, Nigel, sorry, being told I should ask you...
Thanks for bringing them in, Nigel.
Thanks for bringing
them in,
sorry about that. How do you manage to get... I want them in my garden. How can you encourage grass snakes to come into your garden?
I think you've really got to be connected to some habitat as well. But putting a pond in, for instance, is one of the best things you can do because you're attracting the amphibians that they eat. Refuge piles, lots of brush piles for them to go into. But also, as they're the only egg-laying snake, a compost heap.
Lovely. Have you got them in your garden?
I haven't, sadly, no.
I wish I had.
We've had
them
two
in
of
mine.
My favourite animals tonight, kestrel and grass snake. Absolutely delightful things.
Yeah, absolutely gorgeous. And you love that smell, don't you?
I don't mind the smell, actually. It reminds me of my
tangy.
Childhood.
Let's leave that one quickly. Let's go outside and have a look and see how Darren's getting on. Thank you very much for bringing them in. The snakes are gorgeous. Let's have a look. We will.
Beautiful. Lovely, lovely.
Look at that. What have you seen out here now that you've been watching, Darren?
Oh, watching the willow warblers and the hawthorn.
The willow warblers?
Yeah, it's fabulous. The flowers are just dying down, so you've got these stalks almost, but the greens and the dampness that we've got now, for me, is what painting outside is all about, is the environment and the way the paint's reacting with the dampness.
It's absolutely. And has it been raining on you yet, or is this you've just added
no,
this
No, it's
in?
Drizzling. It was drizzling.
Drizzling a bit. I mean, if it rains too hard, it's going to give you trouble, isn't it?
No, it's good. The paper's working for me, which is great.
It's absolutely lovely. Beautiful, and that bird's just magically just... Like, again, you've left out... It's the white, isn't it? It's the paper that you leave behind. And you say that the paper actually moves around. The weather conditions affect the paper, too.
Exactly. I mean, when I brought the paper out this morning, it weighed heavier than it normally does because the moisture is absorbed. And then as soon as I put paint on, it behaves differently, the pigments behave differently. And that's what fascinates me. It's a wonderful thing.
Such a complex thing.
Yeah, oh, water is... It's the simplest of all mediums, but it's so complex at the same time. There's so many elements that can affect it.
I'll have to speak to you about that later on and see after the Martin. Show. Thanks, Dan. Right, it is now time to try to resolve our mystery quiz. Let's just remind ourselves what the questions really were once again. I think we might ask the audience about this. OK, so here are the tattoos. Who do you think this... Which tattoo this ugly person has? Any ideas?
Son,
any advance on son?
I'd like to think you're a wall creeper kind of man.
You're absolutely right. What about this fellow here? Bit on the end, Maureen? Bit on the end? It is that. Chris has got that beautiful... And Chris, can you tell us what it is?
It's a wall creeper. Yes, one of my favourite species of birds. Delightful. Not a British species, not a UK species. One you find on the continent. Well, in fact, all over Asia as well.
We put it correctly, yeah. Beautiful. Now, Kirsty has got perhaps the most fascinating one. Kirsty, can you... Well, hang on a minute. Let me get this right. Level-headed Joe, who got that? Any other odd suggestions as to what it was?
Apart from river maps and...
River maps? So that's a good one. It could be a river.
Yeah,
could
be a river. Sorts of DNA. There was quite a lot of DNA.
DNA, OK. Kirsty, will you please tell us what this curious tattoo is?
It's a copy of the Tree of Life drawn by Charles Darwin in 1837.
That's amazing. Wow. And you can see it says, I think, Charles Darwin. And why did you go for that momentous thing?
Because I'm interested in biology and natural history, and I think Darwin... His work and his life are really interesting and inspirational.
Absolutely fascinating. You were absolutely spot on. So we weren't asked to see it live, but anyway, but thank you very much indeed, where it is. Well done. Well done. Very, very nice. Thank you. We've just got time for... I've lost all the questions now. They've all fallen over. They've all been blown over. But we've just got time for another one. Robin Underwood says, spiders... Why don't spiders stick to their webs? Now, here's a bit being filmed in our wonderful macro studio again, micro studio. Chris, why don't spiders stick to their own webs?
Well, they make three different types of silk, a spider such as this one. They make suspensor silk, which is the stuff which radiates out. That's what holds the web. That's the basic foundation, if you like. Then they make spiral silk, which will go round and give it further structure. And then lastly, they spin something called capture silk. And the capture silk is the sticky stuff, which they put in a certain part of the web where obviously they hope to catch the insects. And that's how they... Well,
but why don't they stick to it?
There's a good question. It's because they have little tiny hairs on the bottom of their feet which prove them from, you know, stop them from sticking to it.
Absolutely fascinating. There's more to that. Right, thank you very much indeed. It's been wonderful. We'd like to say goodbye for now.
But we will be back. Tomorrow.
We'll be back tomorrow. Sorry. Oh, they gave me the wrong thing in the ear. I thought I had to finish it running the credits. Sorry. We're still here. Hooray!